Hello, and welcome to Unit 2, Motivation and Performance Management. Will be the first of a series of videos in Unit 2. And what we're trying to explore in this unit is management tools. And what we're trying to explore in this learning unit is management tools. Management tools as opposed to leadership tools and dimensions, which will be discussed in Unit 3 of this course. Without further ado, let's discuss, however briefly, the importance of motivation in the management of employee performance. Now, whether it is as a result of an increasingly competitive business environment or increasing competition in the provision of labor, one thing's for sure, performance of organization and the requirement that organizations perform well is a given. People in organizations, whether they're seen as human resources or rather human capital, contribute to organizational performance. And therefore, organizations define and monitor their own performance towards fulfillment of organizational or managerial goals. What performance management is, a process of defining what good performance looks like, measuring, monitoring it, rewarding it, and then amending it to respond to strategic changes and environmental changes. Obviously, there are challenges to performance management, and those of you who had annual performance review meetings done in the organizations in which you may have worked before, remember how soul-crushing those could be, how time-consuming they are, and how much information management they entail. Therefore, a significant red tape. So that presents some challenges to an otherwise rational process and very much needed by organizations. A further challenge of many is the increasingly interdependent nature of work. How do we manage and evaluate individual performance when this depends on the performance of the peers? But performance management, in a nutshell, is there for the benefit of the employee as much as for the benefit of the organization. Indeed, it consists of activities meant to improve employee performance. And as mentioned before, though perhaps differently, these activities include identifying key job duties, setting goals or key performance indicators, monitoring performance towards the fulfillment of those KPIs, providing feedback along the line, and then evaluating the overall performance, usually done annually, evaluating the overall annual performance and setting future targets. It helps with employee motivation, but as mentioned before, there are obvious challenges to the process. One is the issue of individual performance. Another is the difficulty to measure certain aspects of performance, particularly if the job has more long-term goals. So for example, if somebody works in public health, how do you manage annually performance indicators that are to do with the provision of public health, which is normally measured in generations or decades? Then there are challenges to do with creativity and innovation if the employees are over preoccupied by key performance indicators and by gathering information about past performance, then they are perhaps more likely to play it safe, therefore decreasing creativity and innovation, also perhaps decreasing the quality of interactions with service users. So for example, if in higher education, one key performance indicator is the amount of scripts one marks in a given period of time, then the quality of the feedback students receive on those scripts is likely to be less than ideal. This is why performance management and performance measures need to be adapted to the specific context in which the organizations operate. For example, public sector organizations are more likely than private sector organizations to pursue long-term objectives. Therefore, performance measurement is likely and should be a little bit more vague, a little bit less prescriptive than when the organizational goals are shorter term. It also needs to be adapted to national culture. When we met in our first lecture, I gave you the example of an American CEO of a British automobile company that rewarded employees with the wrong type of rewards, not taking into account a massive differences in national culture and how these employees are likely to receive those rewards, how they are likely to value them. Organizational strategy would be another determinant of performance measures and, by way of consequence, of performance management. Job type. To understand performance management, one must understand the notion of workplace motivation. This is seen as driven by one side of the equation of mutual expectations of the employees on the one hand and of the employers on the other hand. Such mutual expectations are expressed in a number of notions and theories, and for now, I'm going to propose that we explore one of them, psychological contract. It is a concept introduced by Denis Rousseau, underlined by a philosophy that there is a correspondence of expectations, therefore of values held by employers or managers and employees about their relationship. There is a correspondence between employees' input and the outputs of their employment in the particular organization. Another way of putting this is that psychological contract is an individual's belief concerning mutual obligations existing between themselves and their employer. So it is very important to emphasize the word belief because it is an issue of perception, a perception from the point of view of the employee. There are two different types of psychological contract, two main different types of psychological contract, transactional and relational. Transactional suits short-term performance-linked psychological contract. This is prevalent in the gig economy, for example, which we also discussed briefly the first time we met, or relational, usually long-term, based on emotional involvement and based on a certain degree of loyalty, not just of the employee, but also of the employer. And just bear in mind that managers are usually proxies for the organization or the employer in this relationship. An easy way of picturing psychological contract is to think of what the employee gives and what they receive on the one hand, and on the other hand, of what the organization offers their employees and what they receive in return. To contextualize, here is a mini real-life scenario of psychological contract. A management committee member, so imagine a board member, agreeing to attend meetings regularly and be honorary secretary and taking minutes, doing everything a secretary does in that board. Her psychological contract, this is part of a larger case, and it is indeed a her, even though the first sentence doesn't assign a gender. Her psychological contract includes as inputs into the organization the limited time she has available. And in that limited time, she's determined to make a contribution. So she's inputting time, a contribution, and she expects for this sort of investment to get appreciation from the organization. And again, proxy for the organization can be seen to be the management and also perhaps the peers. Now, what the latter assumes of this particular committee member is that they are committed to the cause of the organization and wish to bring their contribution as much as they can. So they invite her to help out with various other things that are perhaps not in the job description of an honorary secretary. The result of that is that she feels mistreated. She feels like her time is being abused and doesn't feel the appreciation, the recognition that she was banking on. Before the next AGM, she therefore announces that she will need to resign. And at the end of this video, I will ask you to offer a solution to this particular problem. So think of a psychological contract as another kind of contract accompanying the written contract into which an employee gets when they join an organization. That the written contract and the psychological contract form the basis of expectations from the organization. Now, remember that I said context mediates the relationship between inputs and outcomes, and that those can be different according to national culture, according to sector, industry, and so on. For example, ICANN and colleagues 2014 put this idea in a diagram for us. Having in the middle the cultural context, and the more observant of you will be able to see that they are more than just the ones mentioned by the Globe study. You'll have high-low context culture as well, particularism, universalism, and so on. Remember that there are several theoretical dimensions advanced by several writers. The Globe with House and colleagues is just the last one, or the most recent framework out of the many that exist out there on cultural context. So this cultural context is essentially a mediator between inputs and outcomes. What can we infer from this diagram? We could infer that different rewards have different reward value for different people. For example, autonomy may not necessarily be a good reward in a culture of humane orientation. Equally, awards for superior performance, assumed to be individual performance, may not suit very well an organizational context in a national culture in which collectivism is prevalent over individualism. Equally, what this diagram suggests is that different employee characteristics count differently across cultural settings. So, for example, seniority and education count more than individual performance in a country like Korea. Then collegiality and good interpersonal skills and relationships count more than performance in collectivistic cultures like China. Just like social class, for example, counts more in high power distance cultures and a lot less in low power distance cultures like the Scandinavian countries or even the United States. This is why performance appraisal of expatriate employees can be a problem. Now, a lot of the textbooks talk about expats in relation to an international context, but there are many organizations, particularly high tech or knowledge intensive organizations like universities, that rely on staff of a diverse cultural coloring. And so that's, in my view, even more difficult to negotiate, more difficult to apply culturally homogeneous assumptions about what motivates people and how. But because you will because you will read about expatriates a lot, perhaps makes sense to define them. They are citizens of one country working abroad in one of the firm's subsidiaries. So in other words, if somebody moves countries and then starts looking for jobs in the host country, they don't count as expatriates. And this is also why typically expatriates are from economically strong countries. For expatriates, performance appraisal problems can be due to biased cultural frame of reference, expectations of host nations, managers and employees, lack of international experience of home country managers, so of expat managers, reliance on hard data evaluating performance, which doesn't take into account softer variables like cross-cultural awareness, for example. These are important, obviously, but I find a lot less in our textbooks about performance appraisal of culturally diverse workforce. So this is a bit of an open issue for me and perhaps for you as well throughout this course.